speaking with Nick de Blocq this morning from Kinetiko Energy. Nick, morning.
Well, good morning to you from a wet and cold Cape Town pre-dawn, Andrew. Good to chat again.
Good to be catching up with you, Nick. And look, a big week for you. Firstly, you've announced this term sheet here with the IDC to develop South Africa's largest onshore LNG project. So give us a bit of detail as to what's involved here.
Yeah, you know, we've been working very hard, Andrew, in the background to get this far. It all stemmed from a meeting I had at the IDC. We were discussing a special purpose vehicle, if you like, a joint venture that we already had in place, and our path towards manifesting this in the field. And you know, one of the new directors picked up on the fact that we were all thinking way too shallowly, and you know, encouraged his underlings and us to evolve something that resembled more like a multi-hundred well field, delivering eventually multi-hundred megawatt or equivalent power from the field. And this has progressed into the term sheet that we've now signed with the IDC. And that advances, of course, to binding major agreements coming up.
Yeah. So just to clarify, that deal announced earlier with the IDC, that's still in place, is it?
Yes, it is indeed. You know, that's going ahead regardless, but imagines a kind of a 20 well a collection and supplying a certain amount of gas for a certain amount of time. It's very limited. It's ring fenced. It has the ability to increase, but if you like, let's call that SPV zero. SPV one is what we've announced on Monday, which expands our thinking by orders of magnitude, if you like, you know, in the field. So SPV one has a capital value, a capex of about 138 million Aussie dollars, thereabouts. You know, we've done our sums in Rand, but we've converted. So 2/3 of that is equity, 1/3 of that is debt. And the IDC, their 30% of the equity is going to be procured with about 60% of the cost. And our 70% is going to be procured with the remaining 40%. So, you know, it reflects a compensation for expense in country to date, for costs over the years, you know, the last decade plus. They've been kind enough to allow a premium for that, which enables our procurement of our 70% to be so much easier. Yeah.
And we're talking eventually projects totaling what, 1.5 gigawatts?
Yes, staged, obviously. You know, every grouping of 10 wells we can put in the field or less. It remains to be seen what kind of flow rates we get out of that area. Between 8 and 12 wells perhaps can drive a single 5,000 ton per annum LNG cryo box. Multiples of that will lead into a stage whereby we can put a 60,000 ton per annum unit in the field and then envisage multiples of that. So 60,000 ton per annum is equivalent to about a 50 megawatt energy output. So multiples of that leading up to 500 is what we have envisaged right now in this current agreement, but with the ability to expand that by three more times into a 1.5 or one and a half gigawatt output equivalent in the field, which is very, very exciting. It certainly will, long before that, make us the largest energy producer in the sub-region onshore.
Well, Nick, another announcement which you've been keen to get across the line since taking on the role of chief exec at Kinetiko is this maiden reserves and increase to contingent resources. Tell us a bit more about the new numbers.
Yeah, this is so exciting for me personally. You know, it's something I've chased for a while already, and I must thank the shareholders for their patience in this regard. You know, we've announced the intentions, we've announced that we are doing this, and now we've at least got it over the line and we've done it. You know, Sproul has done an excellent job on the new resource report and the maiden reserve report. Just understand that the reserves that we have are defined within about 0.2% of our geography in total. It's a pinprick on the map. It's for a tiny little project, you know, of a couple of tens of wells supplying a little bit of LNG. And it actually fits very snugly into the IDC SPV zero that I've spoken about already, you know, so they will participate in this as well. Discrete to that will be the SPV one and leading into SPV two, looking after the midstream and the downstream. But the reserve, the resource report is so exciting because not the new rules, Andrew, the PMRS rules have changed since the previous report. So the previous report was allowed to give us a complete contingency over all of our rights areas. And that was the 4.9 TCF we've been talking about for a couple of years now. Sproule were more limited with new rules. They could only give us a contingency over the areas where we've actually got holes in the ground. So it makes it so much more impactful that they've managed to increase that 4.9 by more than 20% to just over 6 for the areas that we have proven. And the rest of our rights areas is lumped in as prospective. So we have a 2U of very close to 6, 5.8 at the 2U level, and the 2C of 6. You know, so as we put holes in the ground in the exploration areas, those evolve from prospective into contingent. And of course, as we put the commercial projects together for the production, those 2Cs become 2Ps and they become reserves. And that's the path it's on. We've started that already. In fact, ironically, the 2C number that we've just announced of 6 is already obsolete, because when they cut off, the cutoff date was the 1st of July for this calculation, and I put 3 holes in the ground since then. So they've all moved from U to C, if you like, you know. So the next report is already going to be higher. We know that.
And speaking of activity, what's the plan? What's coming up in the field?
We continue to explore. We've got the rig down in Area 279 near Newcastle. I've got a couple more wells to do down there. Not wells, boreholes for coring. But we have a plan for 5 appraisal wells to the west of Forkswist in the southern part of our Block 271. That will inform, it's about finding sweet spots, Andrew. You know, it will inform our development plan, where it's going to be, how large we can make these well groupings, if you like, clusters. We're going to test one of them for a long period of time. Rather than 3 or 4 days, we're looking at 3 or 4 months, you know, to understand a plateau of flow rates and perhaps a projection to eventual depletion curves. These are all important for your field development planning. And then I've got 5 more locations certified by the authorities in near Amersfoort, where we expand our Korhorn cluster to eventually become a function of the SPV0 with IDC and produce LNG in small scale up there. It will be some production. It'll probably be our initial pilot production, but nothing like the size of what we're planning further south.
And given what you are planning further south, plus the maiden reserves and the new resource numbers, Nick, do you find Kinetiko, are you getting a bit of international attention now about what you're up to?
Oh, Andrew, I'm finding little time to sleep now. We've attracted the attention of the USA, the UK, Australia, everybody in South Africa, you know, is very, very interested in what's been announced. Especially the new, you know, I opened recently, just during the course of this year, 2 new exploration areas in the form of 270 in the south and 272 in the north. And the first core holes we got in the ground in the north were literally, if you chipped a golf ball over the south wall of the Secunda Sasol plant, you know, you'd have hit our rig, strategically put right on their doorstep. And those wells were mind-blowing, absolutely mind-blowing in their response. The amount of gassy sands as a ratio to the total borehole stratigraphy, the geophysics, actually that smaller block has been weighted more for its productivity than the larger 271 block to the south by the Sproule report, if you get into the detail. So the geology up there is just fantastic. You know, we expect to get a lot of gas. And of course, it has raised the attention of Sasol.
Good to speak, Nick. As always, thanks very much.
Thank you, Andrew.